Warning, the following video discusses sex, drugs, murder, and the nightclub culture of the 1980s with the real players of Chippendales. Adult language may be used. Real Chippendales is not affiliated with the Chippendales Company of Las Vegas, and all comments expressed are the opinions of the participants. Be assured they were really there. This video channel does not allow fakes, wannabes, groupies, superfans, stooges, or fraudsters. These are the real people from the original Chippendales.
1983, Los Angeles. Only one nightclub had it all.
As I say to them, gentlemen, if you give me what I want, I'm a sweetheart. The only time you have trouble with me is when you make me break your back.
Take Chippendales recording. Eric Gilbert, Real Chippendales, former creative director. Worked for Steve Banerjee in the 80s. The real founder, the real creator, the this guy was the guy that started Chippendales. There was no partners, no underground connections. Nobody that's showing up nowadays claiming that they are part of the Chippendales story. It was all Steve Banerjee. So I'm here to talk to you about what was real Chippendales and what was at Chippendales. And we're going to continue our conversation with Mr. Dan Peterson. Dan is the most famous face from Chippendales. Dan and I disagree on a lot of things about Chippendales and just about the nightclub business. But one thing we do agree on, and that is that Steve Banerjee, my boss for 8 years, was the original founder, the owner of Chippendales. It's all in corporate papers, the state of California. It's all in eyewitnesses. It's all in pictures. If you meet or see anyone that claims to be a partner, a founder, a co-founder, a co-co-co, 10% of 5% of 3% founder, it's and ask them, where are your pictures? Don't you have one picture of you with Steve Banerjee at Chippendales? I mean, if you're part of this amazing cultural revolution, wouldn't you have some documentation or even a picture? They don't, because they're so listen. Let's talk to Dan Peterson some more. We had some great conversation a couple of weeks ago, and Dan is back online to tell us more about what he thinks about the nightclub business. It's very interesting back then, and I was there too. So let's go. Dan, are you there?
And, you know, so far the portrayal of Snider in there and Dorothy Stratton, you know, Paul definitely was involved at the beginning, but nothing like this. Nothing. He wasn't in there at all with the design of the club. He wasn't even in there near when Nick was there. It was years.
And he was a psycho to put. I mean, obviously to kill kill anybody. But well, and Dorothy Stratton. Just a point of just to make a point here. Side point. She had huge boobs. This woman portraying her in this was flat-chested.
Well, I didn't think she had. I didn't think Dorothy had.
Oh, huge you didn't boobs, think she had? I thought she had huge boobs.
No, she had normal. No, she had. Oh, really? She had a great figure. Normal. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
But see, yeah, I think you're getting too much on if the character is exactly what the character was, and it's not.
Right.
It's not. It to me, it's more about the storyline. And as long as the people were a little bit like it, I could tell already they combined people. Right. There's a combination of different people to make different people. There's the part where I'm up to now, there's a black guy that came in there who wanted to learn from Banerjee.
Yeah, there was no Banerjee wouldn't person. Let a black guy come in and just, can I learn how to be a dancer? I mean, there was a racial tone to Chippendales that didn't allow black guys to just show up. And, you know, Banerjee didn't want black guys drinking in his club. I mean, he always told me they drank water, so...
Yeah, but the way you're showing it,
but that's the way he ran his business.
I don't think Banerjee was racist, and that's where most people played off that he was. Right. Banerjee looked at it from a business standpoint. He knew three other clubs that had gone down because they were popular, and then you got a different clientele in there, and it chased out the clientele that he thought paid.
Right.
So he was very specific on why, and it was nothing. I mean, he had. You know, Tom, he had different people working for him that were black. It wasn't about that.
Yeah,
it was about the club.
Tom Bruchette.
Yeah, it was about the club.
Was his, security.
But most people miss that.
Yeah.
Yeah. But most people miss that. That's the problem with not being there, or even some of the guys that were there that were just there, you know, the dancer that were waiters or hosts that came in and out. That was a problem because you only saw a slice of it.
Right.
And there was only a handful of people that saw more than a slice of the story. And, you know, but again, it is interesting from a Hulu point, the more people you can bring into it, I'm really curious to see who they bring in later, but to bring in Paul and Dorothy and have the murders in there. I mean, that is something that, you know, makes the story bigger.
And just to tell YouTube audience, you know, just because he had an idea of a male strip show, that's not there's no legal challenge. I mean, Banerjee took the idea and made it better. So there's no challenge to that. And he didn't owe Paul anything except thank you, you know. And
yeah, but that's where you and I have we disagree on that as well. I think that, you know, a lot of the credit does have to go to Paul because he brought it in, and he brought it in a whole different reason than people think is why it ended up at Chippendale or ended up there. But you do have to give credit. Everyone has ideas. Paul's was a little more than an idea. He brought something there that worked. But you have to give Banerjee all the credit.
Do you think he brought him an idea that was really saleable? I mean, a saleable idea?
Oh, no. What Paul brought him was what Banerjee created Chippendales with. But again,
then he went on to the next generation of shows, which was with, hopefully we'll get him on this, YouTube channels, Richard Barsh and Henry Flores. That was the next generation of the Chippendales show.
Well, that was the first. That was really the first generation.
It wasn't Paul.
Was the first generation. And
just so let you folks know, I came into Chippendales in 83. I met Banerjee briefly in 79. I was just going to college. But I really didn't know Chippendales until I was working for him in 83. And Dan started, you started in
80. It was already started.
Between Dan and I, we covered the whole thing, but different times.
Yeah, I mean, the thing is that, I mean, you have to give Steve all the credit. It was all Steve's. But
I believe that.
What I'm saying is that it would never happen.
Dan and I disagree about a lot of things, but we do strongly agree that Steve Banerjee was the core. And I've said this at the beginning of the channel. He is the owner, the creator, the founder of Chippendales. It was Steve Banerjee, and we agree wholeheartedly about that.
Well, yeah, and that's, you know, from people that were there, that's not disputed.
Yeah.
It's from people that are wannabes, people that are listening to the wrong people,
the
that want their 15 minutes of fame.
Right.
Well,
the
that's
stooges,
the people that's
the goose.
I don't know. Whatever they are, it's, you know, you always get that.
You won't find them on this YouTube channel. They won't be here.
Yeah. But the bottom line of it is Steve took something and ran with it. And where we also, you and I disagree, is that you thought he was, you know, a very good businessman. To me, I probably had dinner with him 100 times.
Yeah.
When I was there the first couple, 2-3 years, and again, it was 40 odd years ago, so it sort of blends together, but I would say twice a week we went out to dinner, if not 3 times.
Well, Dan,
and we talked about everything.
Dan, right. You were a friend to Steve Banerjee, and
Banerjee
treated you like a close friend.
Well, he treated
me. I was an employee.
Like,
I worked. You know, I worked as the.
I don't know if he treated me like a friend, but he looked at me as being this naive kid that got thrown into this, you know, this pool of sharks, and he honestly tried to mentor, father me, whatever you want to call it.
Right.
To make me get to a certain point, but I came out of business school. So he would ask me all kinds of questions about the business side of it,
right.
My opinion, which nobody knew about. How I knew nothing about a nightclub. I just got to tell you that when you have money, you can make a million mistakes and money fixes it. And Steve made a lot of mistakes, and he fell into a lot of great
things. But he wasn't afraid to make mistakes. And that's why Chippendales became a huge success, is that he took a lot of risks, and he never took it personally when they failed. When something failed, he would just go on to the next, you know.
Yeah, I don't. But again, I don't think he was looking at them as risks. They were, this is what he would do. You know, doing a calendar, is that a risk? Yeah, but it's something that makes sense.
Right.
You know, the reason that Nick got involved was because he wanted to, it was being too stereotyped as a stripper, you know, low class, sleazy joint. And he wanted to make, you know, legitify it and bring it worldwide. And he thought by bringing in somebody with some credentials, right. It would have made.
Banerjee, you know, was kind of a sucker for credentials. I mean, he saw that DeNoia had an Emmy, and even though it was an Emmy for a kid's show. Which I thought was a little pervy, but you know, anyway. So yeah, it was an Emmy, and Banerjee was impressed by an Emmy award. Yeah,
he wasn't a choreographer.
No, he
was nothing.
He was nothing.
No, but
and they showed him choreographing a scene in this. I just watched the Hulu Tonight, and I'm like, that's ridiculous. They wouldn't even do that. They're doing it outside too. They never rehearsed outside.
Again, story.
Yeah.
A story, you know, this is a movie or a show. This is story. This is trying to make everything that's not in one place.
And Irene was not as, you know, bookkeeping.
No, and that's
bitch.
Where you and I have different opinions as well. Because when he met Irene, I've heard different stories, but I can tell you, I used to go down to this restaurant and she worked there, and I used to buy this stuff for Steve, for her, and Steve would give me extra money to give her. So the stories that are out there about she was a nurse, she was an accountant, she was all this
right.
stuff.
I heard she was a nurse. Later. Yeah, I heard she was
a nurse.
That's
what I heard that, but she wasn't a nurse when I was there, she was working at this drive-up French restaurant. Hmm. It was a drive-up French restaurant that was on the way from Chippendales to Banerjee's house in Marina Del Rey.
Right.
And that's how, from my recollection, that's how we met her.
He lived in Playa del Rey.
Well, he lived in Playa, right. But this was somewhere in between Playa and I think it was in Marina Del Rey. But it was in that right
he
now.
Actually lived, he actually lived across the street from runway number 4. LAX.
I know.
And he invited me over to his house one night, and I couldn't figure out, it was really dark. I couldn't figure out why there was no houses on the other side of the street. And then we were talking and suddenly the whole house started shaking like an earthquake. And I said, oh my God, we have to get out of here. It's an earthquake. He goes, no, that's the plane. It was a 747 taking off.
Yeah. Well, like I said, the storyline itself,
expensive home.
You know, going back to, if we're going to go over the Hulu thing, the way it started, you know, Steve did work at a gas station.
He did.
He raised himself
into becoming the manager and made more money. And then he owned gas stations.
He bought a couple gas stations.
I think they were Shell, Shell stations.
And the way that he paid for it was at the time there was the oil embargo type of thing, whatever it was. And he would get Mexican gas illegally.
Wow.
And that's how we ended up building those gas stations and selling those and buying the club.
Yeah, because there was a gas crisis at the time. Yeah, wow. Yeah. I didn't know that he bought Mexican gas.
He did. And he told me all this stuff. You know, he told me a lot of the things on how he got in.
See, he's more of a shark than they show in this Hulu thing. They make him out to be, like I said, a little dopey Indian guy. He was pretty ruthless.
No, but I think that he learned all of this as he went. I think that I don't think that any of this stuff was preconceived. No. I honestly think that, you know, everything
but
at Chippendales,
all
has
the balls.
Stuff he learned.
He had big balls to do stuff like that. I mean,
I don't know. I didn't. I don't know. I mean, there was nothing that I saw when I was there that I thought was that.
He wasn't
know,
afraid
risky.
Of gangsters, mob. He wasn't afraid of TV. big shot executives like George Schlatter. And well, I mean, he was, but he wasn't afraid. But he wasn't afraid to talk to him and deal with him. He really had no fear, you know, except I mean, he did and he didn't. You know, I mean, he would take a risk.
I think he was. I think people are giving him too much credit all the way around. I mean, he honestly was he did an unbelievable job with what he had. That was this, you know, lightning strike, and he was there at the right time, and he kept pursuing it. And like I said, I was with him when he talked to mobsters. He was, you know, he was respectful. He was a TV junkie or movie junkie.
He was
like I was. He loved the idea. But
when I worked for him, and I was in, you know, I was in this cocoon with him in the car and the office and everything, hours and hours for years and years. And he always spoke of things with conviction. It wasn't like, well, I don't know. Maybe I don't, you know, there was never deliberating or, you know, screwing around. He was always speaking with conviction because he had a vision in his head of what he wanted to. Yeah, he made a decision.
And then he did it. I agree with that. He would make a decision. He would decide which way to go. But again, it came down to labels. Him and I got in a little bit of a heated, it sort of towards when I left, when he did a calendar and he hired these models from a modeling agency that were very skinny.
Yeah,
horrible. And to him,
they looked a little gay because they didn't look like men that women love. You know, I mean,
they were, listen. They were lean, and women loved every type of guy. You could put anybody in there. But
they didn't like a wispy. They didn't like a wispy guy with no chest development. They liked, you know, they liked a man.
No,
but I mean, they wanted it.
No, they liked everybody. They liked everybody. You got to realize there was 300 women in there that were drunk, and I'm not talking about from the calendar. I'm talking about from the
drunk
club.
Yeah, they were drunk.
Well, yeah, not everybody, but everyone was tipsy. It was loud. That's the one thing so far they have not been able to show the amount of energy in that club. And who knows if anyone could, but that was the one complaint I had on everything I saw. The amount of energy in that tiny club
was amazing. They didn't capture on Hulu. In Hulu, they have this wide, huge dance floor. It wasn't two stories. It was one story, triangular, small, like suffocating small. But that was the perfect club atmosphere. You want it so small that people feel like they can feel the energy. That's what you want.
The only way we got from one side of the club to the other was because we wore spandex pants, and you'd have to slide in between these women as you walked. You couldn't get through them. It was bumper to bumper.
That's true.
But no one's been able to do that. Nobody. I know it's a difficult thing to do. And when you have people producing and directing that have not been there, the director probably wasn't alive. You know, he's probably 25, 30 years old. Yeah. But when you weren't in there, you cannot understand the amount of energy that was in the place. And that's what I was getting to. Steve would try out guys, right? So he'd bring them in, he'd put them in the lineup, which was, you know, they introduced each guy one by one, and the women would clap and they'd make up some little thing about him. And he would bring guys in there, and if they got no response, that was the only night they were there. But every single person that came in got something. They got something, whether they were built, whether they were short, whether they were tall, whether they were skinny, blonde, brunette. There were so many women in there that I learned there that in life that everybody has their own gift or specialty, and there's always somebody out there that's going to love that. And I learned that there. And so they missed that part of it. Right. You know, the guys that they used, I think, were more
later,
like the
Banerjee
original guys.
Later, Banerjee brought in somebody to replace DeNoia after he killed him. He brought in a Steve Merritt, who was over the top, very, very gay man, who brought in then these gay backup dancers who looked like they should be working in some rough club in West Hollywood, like a leather club.
I thought that was good.
You did. Well, I thought the women, I would tell Steve, they're too gay for the show, no, Steve.
So here's the thing. They were backup dancers. That was giving.
And nothing wrong with being gay, but the show was meant for, women. In fact, Banerjee wouldn't even allow employees like me to go into the club wearing a shirt because I wasn't bare chested or whatever. He made me go in through the back and stand behind the door because it wasn't about guys. It was, the show was all about women and what they wanted to see, which was a bare chested man in the uniform, the costume.
But I think you're missing the part, and men will miss this part. The backup dancers needed to be dancers. You know, at the beginning, they weren't dancers. Henry was a dancer. No one was a dancer. These were just guys. So when Merritt came in, who was a real choreographer,
Steve Gurry wasn't a dancer.
Oh no, but none of them were dancers, right. You know. And when he brought in a coordinated group, or
these people, they weren't dancers. Well,
they weren't even close to dancers, yeah, but that's opposing. Not what they were there for.
Yeah.
They were the leading man. You know, they were the leading man with all these other people behind them.
Right.
And I thought that was great. And it was choreography. And let me tell you, Nick did some choreography that was good too. I'm not taking.
Now, you never did. You never were in the show. You were in the opening, right? I don't think you ever had an act.
I
didn't.
I wouldn't do the show. That was my fight with Nick. His third day there, when we went out to dinner and talked about the show, and he tried to tell Banerjee that he was going to fire me if I didn't do the show, and Banerjee laughed at him. So, I mean. Banerjee,
if people didn't, wanted to use Dan as the premier face, the flagship face.
No, it wasn't even that. He knew me. He knew who I was.
But he wasn't going to let Denoya get rid of you because he was making.
Oh, yeah,
he was making a lot of money off your face, and you had a really recognizable.
That's giving
good face.
Yeah, but that's giving Denoya too much credit at the beginning. Banerjee wasn't sold on Denoya at the beginning. At all. Hmm. I mean, he brought Denoya in. He paid him weekly to put a show together.
This and they weren't partners. Like let's just clear that up.
They weren't partners at all. He's
a partner.
The way a photographer was hired to do a job, and he did the job, and it was tough. And, you know, where they said, I think in the Hulu thing, he said, fire everybody. He's hiring all new people. That wasn't true either. That wasn't, you know, Banerjee would never let that happen. And I honestly think that when Denoya came in, not just Denoya, but after the original, I think it went downhill for me because you lost that personal touch. I think the original show, and it had to progress. Don't get me wrong. It had to progress somewhere.
Right.
But I think with Roger, Zorro, and you know, the original show, women felt they were part of it.
Right.
They were able to be around
it. I never
it.
Saw as the original you, show because I came in 83.
Yeah, as soon as you put backup dancers and the guys did twirls and spins and the lead guy went back and forth and there was 5 minutes of fluff dancing, the women lost it. You know, it didn't have that personal touch that it used to do.
And the Steve Merritt show started in 86, I think, 86.
More than 86? That's about when I was gone, 85. But then the kiss and tips started to go away because they wanted it more, you know, legit. Mm. But and I understand that it has to progress somewhere, and that's where you have a risk. Which way are you going to go with the show? But the women felt more special when it wasn't that type of a show. And when it became that type of a show, it changed a little bit. Not a lot, because they went on the road. The market opened up. It wasn't just people flying into California. You know, the New York show was a huge venue. Mm. I mean, we were paying off the fire department, the police department at Chippendales 3 nights a week. And, and that was just to get an extra 50 to 80 people in there. I don't know if they're going to show that.
Banerjee was a real nightclub owner. He understood you had to do things like that, you know. There had to be a door policy that kept certain people out of the club, black people or brown skin, even Indian people that he was in himself. He said, I wouldn't even let myself in the club.
He did say that. But
and he would stand around the corner of the door smoking a cigarette and looking at everybody that went into that through that door. And he had this nonverbal deal with the doorman, you know, don't let, you know, okay, go ahead.
Well, they knew. He told them, they knew. I mean, he told everybody, that wasn't a secret at all.
Right.
But like you said, at least from my point of view, it is a prejudice, but it wasn't a prejudice the way
people
think.
See, this is where I disagree with Dan. I think it was institutionalized racism, but it wasn't just Banerjee, because my job for Chippendales was to go to all the nightclubs at the time in New York, and I was spent weeks in New York at the Tunnel and Danceteria and CBGB's, and I went to the Tunnel and Studio 54. So those clubs, you couldn't get in unless you were a good-looking white guy or with a hot-looking chick, or just being a good-looking white guy.